this stage, I would like to introduce Sthandiwe Msomi, who will share a few words. She is here. She will share a few words. She is from the South African Youth Economic Council. We heard from Dr. Palilo Hotla the importance of youth being part of the fabric of thinking and solutioning for this country. But most importantly, black women, young black women, young black intelligent women. I introduce to you Sthandiwe.
Ukuthi lo okhethe le ngoma was on point. Sanibonani. Ninjani? Anginizwa ninjani? Indeed, amandla. Awethu. Thank you so much. As introduced, my name is Sthandiwe Msomi. I serve as the national spokesperson of an organization called the South African Youth Economic Council. And before I get into my remarks, I just want to acknowledge the leadership of Rise Mzansi. I'd like to acknowledge the national chair, Ms. Vuyisa Ramakgopa. Thank you so much for the invitation today, as well as Mr. Songezo Zibi, the national leader and all leaders of Rise Mzansi. The South African Youth Economic Council is a youth-led organization, and our mandate is to wage a relentless war on youth unemployment and the exclusion of young people from the mainstream economy. We looked at the mining sector, we looked at the construction sector, we looked at the finance sector, ICT, and realized ukuthi high corner. These sectors are dominated by old white men who descend from old money that has enabled their own wealth. And so we as young people, not just as young people, but South Africans in general, must stand up and say, we too want to own mines. We too want to own the Vodacoms and the Telkoms and the WBHOs and all these companies that are profiting from the big money that is circulating in this country. And so for us, it's important to engage with Rise Mzansi and any political party on what economic policies should do to enable the integration of young people into this economy. And so I think that's why it was important for us today to honor this invitation. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to start off by a quote that I saw on social media yesterday. It said, poor countries are not underdeveloped, they are overexploited. And I want to, yes. And I want to make an addition to that. We allow it. We allow the overexploitation of our country. We allow the Anglo-Americans, the big companies, to extract our minerals and export them and sell it back to us at higher prices. In fact, we dine with them at gala dinners and say, please come, increase investment, take our resources to give people peace jobs as miners underground and other jobs that don't really change people's lives materially. And so it's important for economic policy to stop that process of allowing our people to be overexploited. We need to take the accountability to say, how are we going to craft policy that is going to ensure that our people benefit from every resource that this country has to offer? Indeed, I think Dr. Palilo Hotla and other speakers before me came and pointed out the statistics of unemployment and economic growth, so I don't need to do that. But I think my focal point today is to focus on two of Rise Mzansi's pillars, which is economy as well as governance. So I just finished my research paper at Wits University in economics, and I was studying the relationship between public debt as well as investment into our country. Now, at the moment, our debt to GDP ratio in South Africa is around 72.7%. And around other African countries as well, the number is exorbitantly high. But the funny thing that I found out is that even though we are told that our fiscal environment is not conducive for investment, we're told that we've got crime and all of these other things, we still have a lot of private investment coming into this country. And it's held by the fact that we've got a strong commodity sector. It's held by the fact that the private sector is functioning outside. I mean, Sandton and Alexandra is a perfect example. We've got these dichotomies of environments in our country, yet the private sector still thrives. People are still pumping money into business because they know what is profitable for them. And so if that can happen, even under fiscal constraints that we face in our country, we need to ask ourselves how we redirect those resources to the majority of the people in this country. Now, I think for Rise Mzansi, in your economic policy conversations, we need to talk about why we have a strong mineral sector, but we don't have a strong manufacturing sector. All of the things that we use, our cell phones, our chairs, every single material thing that is engineered, a lot of those minerals come from the soil that we stand on, right? And so it only makes sense for that sector to be connected to a manufacturing sector that is going to employ hundreds of unskilled labor, unemployed people sitting at home. And so we need to talk about how we're going to drive in massive investments into this country to employ people. You know, sometimes when you go back, Gokasi, and you see people sitting around at 12 o'clock, the sun is out midday, you're like, why are people not working? It's as if you could just build tons of factories and put people in there to be productive. Because in that way, you're going to eradicate crime. People will not have time to engage in criminal activities at 11 o'clock in the day, right? And so we need to make this economy hospitable for big business to drive industrialization, to manufacture products in this country, and to also make it competitive. Because we also have the argument of how we can't develop manufacturing sector because China is already paying people low wages, and so it's not competitive for us. If that's the case, and if we have to sacrifice low wages, the government must be bold and subsidize essential goods for ordinary working class people. Because obviously, I wouldn't want to go work if I know I'm just going to earn 2,000 rand and then, like, what's that? That's going to finish in a matter of a week, right? But if we want to get people into work, we also need to look at how we can ensure that those same people who are working have the ability to afford food on the table. They have the ability to own a home, to own financial assets, and other things that actually give meaning to being a dignified human being, which our people have not had the opportunity to have, right? So those types of interventions, I think, are quite important if we want to bring in that mass industrialization that we want to have. Another point as well that was considered was the point of science and innovation, which my predecessor speaker spoke about. Science is critical for any sort of economic growth. Ask any economic student. The one thing that will increase productivity, increase growth, is science and innovation. And that links right back to developing our manufacturing capacity as a country. If we are able to produce goods competitively, if we are able to ensure that we can come up with the latest innovations, we will have value to add to the world. At the moment, the only value we have to add is the diamonds and the platinum that are determined by other people in terms of prices, not us. So when the commodity prices are down, we are down as well, and we don't want to be subjected to that, right? And so science and technology is key for that. I also think something that the Rise Mzansi leadership must consider in these discussions is the role of DFIs in this country. We've got the IDC, we've got DBSA, we've got NYDA, we've got NEF, we've got so many developmental finance institutions. But yet, why aren't we seeing the construction of infrastructure in our townships? Why do our rural areas still have gravel roads? What are these developmental finance institutions financing, right? Because we can agree that the financial institutions, Abo Absa, Standard Bank, they have their own markets. But if we say that we have DFIs that are dedicated to development, that development must go to our people, right? And so Rise Mzansi must consider what conditions are put forward to these DFIs that we control, that we employ board members to run. It can't be that an IDC is taking 8.5 billion from a just energy plan that is just going to go to a few business people here and there who are going to supply us with solar panels and all these other things, whereas an IDC must finance development in our communities, right? And so a simple thing like building shopping malls in our townships that are, you know, paraded by international conglomerates and multinational corporations. Those shopping malls must be built by youth-owned construction companies in the community. We've got our young people studying civil engineering and all these degrees, yet they aren't the ones getting the funding from that DFI to build a shopping mall there. Those shopping malls must have our people who make clothes, who make pottery, who make the things that we have, so that we can start to develop our own local economies. The DFI must not just be there to just finance the establishment, because what are we doing then if we're doing that? So we need to consider that as well. I think also the issue of education is important to be considered in this policy discussion. And I was having a conversation about this with the Sis Vuyiswa the other day, about how our education system is not training people to do stuff. Our education system is training anthropologists and social scientists, which is great, but we need people in STEM fields. We need people who are going to be able to look at a broken pipe in Khayelitsha and say, how do I fix that? Instead of waiting for some company to be given a tender to do it, and then the company doesn't do it anyways, right? And so we need to ensure that from a primary school level, our young people are taught to do stuff, are taught to fix lights, are taught to make clothes, are taught to do things that are going to add value in local communities. And yes, we need the intellect, we need the theorists, we need all types of people in society for all people to achieve their highest potential. But I think we all need to rally behind a specific goal that we want to reach, and that is increasing productivity in our communities, that is increasing investment in our communities. I also think that Rise Mzansi must consider breaking the bureaucracy that is involved in trying to start a business in this country. Our young people have to jump through hoops and leaps. Those who want to apply for mining rights need to wait for 7 years. Those who want to explore our ground need to wait for this DG and that person to do that. And that is unreasonable. Because also, while you're waiting in that process, you've already invested millions into that project that you don't even know will be approved, and it's just dependent on how the DG feels on that day, right? And so we need to deal with the issue of bureaucracy and red tape, and I know that our current president has spoken about it. We've developed the whole department of red tape, but we haven't seen much being done. And so we hope that the Rise Mzansi leadership can address that and come up with new ways to break the bureaucracies that we have. And I know all of these ideas are great, and people are going to ask, but how do we finance this? Because, as I said, our government is literally using things like commodity booms and the extra revenues that they get from the mining sector to pay off debts or to pay a social relief of distress grant. And so no money is actually going into investments, right? But I think we need to be creative about this. And in thinking about that, we need to look at what sectors we need to target to try and raise the revenue that we need. Firstly, is the financial services sector. Not only is the financial services sector still really untransformed and not serving the purpose of being a lender and borrower for people, for borrowers and savers in the economy, but they've even found ways to make extra revenue from not lending out loans. So all these banking transactions that you do, all these other things that you do through banking apps, those things generate revenues for financial services. I mean, in fact, I was reading a book by Ayabonga Tawe. It's called The Economy on Our Doorstep. I think every South African should read it. And in it, he did a study where he analyzed the proportion of revenues that financial institutions were getting from actually doing their job of extending loans and all the extra other services that they have that are non-interest related. And that revenue accounts for at least close to 50% of their revenues, right? From doing something outside of their mandate. And so look at taxing that, because they're making extra revenues from us downloading all their apps and doing all of our transactions. And if that's not serving the purpose of giving young black people loans to start businesses, then tax all the other activities that they're doing to try and raise the funds that you need to build a bridge in Mlazi or build a road in Pongolo or to give resources to our people. I also think that it's important for governments, should Rise Mzansi take up government, to partner with young people who want to invest in this economy. And if that means being an equity partner in the businesses that young people start, then do it. Because all of the entrepreneurs that were created through colonialism were created through state power. IDC was not created just because they wanted to have fun. They created it because they knew that the mining sector was developing and it was going to make them billions and billions of rands. So partner up with young people who have businesses to ensure that those young people don't worry about paying salaries and overhead costs, but they know that they are well-funded and they can actually produce what they were meant to produce. Because at the moment, lots of our young youth-owned businesses are failing, and we need to ensure that they don't fail. And also, we need to stop reducing young black people to owning spaza shops and tuck shops and car washes. Those are great. Those put food on the table today. But we are talking about young people who own factories, young people who own mines, young people who own laboratories, young people who own big assets that are going to have a multiplier effect in this economy. And that is going to require government to partner up with young people in this country to make that happen. I will draw to a close very, very soon, and I think I'll touch on the governance aspect of Rise Mzansi's pillars. I don't have much to say on this, but I think it's important because as we operate in an environment where government is cutting budgets and government doesn't have money to do things, I often look at people like local councillors and the resources that they have to ensure that they bring change to their communities. And I saw this when I was back at home, where I run an organization called Kanyisa Foundation. And I didn't really have much of a budget, but I knew that young people in townships don't know much about applying to universities or getting bursaries or what business opportunities are out there. And so it just took me working with a counselor to try and have events and seminars to bring that information to people. And I asked myself, why don't local counselors do that? They've got access to municipal budgets, they have resources. Why do I, as an ordinary citizen, have to take money from my own pocket when someone is employed to do this and someone is voted into power to do this job, right? And so I think Rise Mzansi must develop a cadre that is a servant leader. Someone who will go out of their way to ensure that they serve their people. We need to change the culture of governance in this country. Some things don't need you to have 100 million rand budgets. They just need you to genuinely love abantu, you know? They just... and not love yourself. So I think we need to change the culture of the type of politician we have, of the type of comrade that we have, and ensure that we bring in excellence and servant leadership into every single ward, into every single province, into parliament as well. And so I think I've given more than enough policy considerations, and I look forward to reading what is going to come out of this conference. But I'd like to say thank you so much for the opportunity to address you today. And I encourage you all to rise. Thank you very much.